I wondered if I could get an amen. Amen. Let's try that again. This is a good night.
Amen.
Okay. It's a good night for Annette. It's a good night for the world. And it's a good night for the church.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Annette is taking a big step forward into living the life God has made her for. And let's not be too fast to go past that, because that is a good thing for the world.
Amen. Amen.
The world is a better place when any one of God's children moves farther into the fullness of life for which they were made. We rejoice that Annette is being set apart as a deacon to do the ministry that serves, it says, all people, particularly the poor, the weak, the sick, and the lonely. All people. It is so easy for those of us in ordained ministry to have our heads under the hood of the church, tinkering with this and patching up that we forget literally countless people who know the name of Jesus only as a swear word. Or by the dreadful actions of some of his followers. There are so many people near this building and around the world whose hearts are famished for a hunger they cannot name. You and I might call their emptiness a thirst for the living God, or a need to experience the salvation of Christ. But some of them can't even imagine there is anything more in life. But how in the world are we going to be able to help them name that hunger and have their hearts filled if someone doesn't, in the name of Christ, tend to the needs and wounds that come from being poor, weak, sick, lonely, or rigid? It is a glorious moment for the church, from one end of the vineyard to the other, when we set someone apart as a deacon. We are calling on Annette to embody that gospel oxymoron that just won't go away no matter how hard we try to forget it. The last is the first is the last, the greatest one is the servant of all. We gain our lives by laying them down. And yes, we're setting Annette apart tonight, but we aren't setting her apart to be our designated servant. The one who represents all of us on the front lines in ministry to the world while we engage in more comfortable pursuits. We are inviting her to engage in ministry to those the church often forgets in a compelling way that calls all the rest of us to follow her there. We are asking her to let her servant heart burn so brightly that she becomes an icon of Christ the servant that draws us into his way of living. The church will only be what it is meant to be fully and do all that it is intended to do when we, each one of us, can say with Paul, we do not proclaim ourselves. We proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. I am going to be bold enough to suggest that we are not gathered here tonight to call the Holy Spirit down on you, Annette, so that you may do this ministry for a limited time. I looked. I don't see anything in the prayers that has a time limitation on them. I don't see 6 months or a year in that. You will go on, soon we hope, into the fullness of ministry God has made you for. But taking on the form of a servant unto death, even death on a cross, is integral to Christ's priesthood. What we're celebrating here tonight is the heart of all ministry, clergy and laity, and we're inviting you to lead us into it. When we become sacramental ministers, we tend to become more focused on building the church up from the inside. But the deacon's heart in us must always ask, to what end? To what end do we build up the church? The church doesn't exist for itself. It exists for the world. It exists for that beaten up, hungry world for which Jesus offered himself. And if there has ever been a time when the church needs its pastoral leaders to, quote, interpret the needs, concerns, and hopes of the world to us all, I don't know when that time has been. We, the church, have been absent so often from so many places that much of the world around us no longer misses. A couple of cautions as we celebrate. God has called Annette to be an icon of Christ the servant who set aside his life. Ordained ministry does mean we're giving up some other options on how we spend our lives. Our lives are set apart to serve Christ in the church in particular ways, and it's not a part-time occupation. We are called to set ourselves aside in countless ways. How else can we become an icon of Christ's servant? But setting ourselves aside is not the same thing as not having a self. And it's not the same thing as not being ourselves. We remain precious creatures in whom God delights. You. Being a servant minister means with strength, out of strength, out of purpose, setting aside our selfishness and our comfort so that others may see in us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Many of us, when we approach ordination, think with Jeremiah, I am only, in this case, only you. But whatever we name as our shortcoming, I'm too young, I'm too old, I'm too short, I'm too tall, I'm too experienced. What we're saying is, I'm only me. And I don't think enough. Now, Annette, you will have many opportunities greater than the one you have tonight to think that you're not enough. Jeremiah was much more emphatic about how God should have chosen someone else once he got going in his ministry. God has called you. And as God said to Jeremiah, God says to you, do not be afraid. I have put, I am putting, and I will put my words in your mouth. Do not be afraid. I am with you to deliver you. We are not here tonight to say, good luck. We are here to pray with your bishop. Give your Holy Spirit to Annette. Fill her with grace and power and make her a deacon in your church. We have confidence in you, but we have more confidence in the Holy Spirit working through you. That you that we know and trust. You will do what God has called you to do by and only by the Holy Spirit. We rejoice with you, Annette, that you in the name of Christ are moving ever more forward into who you are, a servant of Christ. And this night, we invite you to draw us forward into living out what that means for each one of us.